Oh man, it's been a long time since I've done one of these, hasn't it? Yes, System Talk. By the way, this was kind of a spin-off of VGR back when I first did it. I thought this was going to be the thing I did, and I realized, there really isn't that many systems I could do this forever. But then again, at the time, it seemed like an okay idea. So now, in this one, as you can see from the title, I'm going to be talking about the Game Boy. Now, the original one that many of us call the brick. Not the Game Boy Light, not the Game Boy Color, not the Game Boy Pocket, the Game Boy, the original one. The one with the lavender two buttons for A and B and the monochrome screen. And it was big. It took four double A's. That one. I really like this thing. My first handheld, I should mention. I also had a, well, I didn't really, it wasn't mine, but there was someone I used their Game Gear a lot, so it was more mine than it was theirs. They really didn't use it much. They didn't have any interest in it. They didn't even understand what the point of it was, to be honest. They rather used their NES, and they did, so I used their Game Gear. That's all there is to it. I had a Game Gear without spending the money, or my parents spending the money, whichever way you wanted to see it back then. Anyway, I really had fun with this thing. Now, I've said before, my favorite in the Game Boy line was and always will be the Game Boy Advance, for many reasons, but I'll get to that whenever I do get to that. But first, I gotta do the Game Boy Color before that one. But anyway, I didn't have a Pocket or a Light. Light was only in Japan. Anyway, the original Game Boy, pretty chunky. You could fit it in your pocket if you had big pockets in your pants, or you can try and like squeeze it in there without risking breaking the damn pants. I did that a couple times. I found a way to get it in there. It wasn't so convenient carrying around extra games, though. Many of the games came in these little clear plastic holder things. Game Gear also had that too for their games. Slightly different shape, obviously, but it was pretty much the same thing. I used to put those in the other pocket, so one side was the device and the other side was the games. I used to carry, I think it was like three games on me, and then you had one in the thing itself, so there's four. And the one that was in there, since it didn't have a case, was in the Game Boy. You put that in one of the cases of the other ones you took out. See? By the end, before I got rid of it, which was about 4 years ago now, I got rid of mine. My original one, by the way. No one else ever used it. I took care of the thing, but I used it so much the screen started to die. But where I took it in, they didn't care. I just replaced the screen, I think. Whatever. The guy actually said he's impressed at how well the thing is, because most every single one he's ever encountered, except for when they were new, obviously, were beat to shit and all that kind of stuff. It was like, I told him, I take care of my stuff. I do. That's how I have portable CD players that still work since they were new and work just as good as they were new. Yet I use the crap out of them. One of them I still use every now and then. Whatever. I don't have an MP3 player anymore. Mine broke. I can't find any to replace it with. They don't cost a whole ton. Okay. Anywho. My original Game Boy was the one, that came with Tetris, which, by the way, was my favorite game. I played for it. Was my favorite game for it. In case you're wondering, yes, before this is over, I will be talking about Pokemon. Don't worry. Or Pokemon. I never called it that. I didn't even call it Pokemon for the longest time. But we'll get to that when we get to it. I still debate every now and then making a thing just talking about Pokemon, but we'll see someday. Anyhow, speaking of Tetris, since I just brought it up, I've mentioned this once or a few times. Most of the time when I mention it, I just mention it when I'm talking to someone, like private message or on Skype or something like that. I actually was in a Tetris tournament, and it was for the Game Boy one. Out of 25 people, I placed third. I kind of fell apart towards the end. And now I am so out of it, I couldn't play for shit. But I could still play it decently. Better than some people who just started playing Tetris, let's put it that way. I still remember how you're supposed to do it correctly. But whatever. I'm nowhere near the level I used to be, let's put it that way. Tetris is a lot of fun, but it also keeps your mind working. I was reading a thing that it supposedly can keep, like, elderly, not, I wouldn't say elderly, but people on the verge of there, like, when your mind starts slipping. Things like, they didn't mention specifically Tetris is the only one, but things like Tetris, because it requires a lot of thinking and it activates certain parts of the brain, it keeps you going. Doing that kind of stuff, it can help you keep going. So Tetris not only is very fun and entertaining and fast and frantic and makes you freak the hell out when you think you're about to lose after playing a long time, you're really close to the end. It's also good for keeping your brain going, apparently. But that's another thing entirely. I guess you could think of it the brain age game for the Game Boy. But whatever. Going back to what I originally was talking about, sorry, you know how I jump around. I go on for a long time, that's the point of these. Anyway, moving back. The original Game Boy, by the time when I got rid of it, which was about 4 years ago now, I think, whatever. It was way before I was doing videos on here, so no, there isn't no video of me showing it. I had about, I'm going to say 15 games for it. I actually remember most of them. For example, I had the Test Drive 6 on it, nowhere good as the Dreamcast computer, PlayStation, or whatever other versions were on for it. It's a better 3D game than it was a 2D game. It was top down, it was controlled like crap. Anyway, I had that one game, which I forgot the name of again after someone helped me with it a couple months ago. I feel bad, I'll find it again. I had the Godzilla game for it, where he looks like one of the things from Bubble Bobble. It's not that good, I liked it back then. I also had, of course, I had Nintendo games, obviously. I had Mario Land, which is really good. I like it. It's really different compared to a lot of other Mario games. I always wish they made another game like it. You know, short, too. I liked how short it was. It was more like an arcade game to me in my head. I also had Atlantis 6 Golden Coins. I think that's what the subtitle is. It's basically the first game Wario appears in. And most of the time, you see him, he's just this shadowy figure that moves back and forth across the castle. I really love that game. I still do to this day. The problem is I just can't stand playing Game Boy game on an emulator because, you know, I can make the window a really small size, but holy crap, does it still look bad? I'd rather play it on the damn original Game Boy screen. It looks a lot better to me. By the way, yes, I am aware of the supervision. Speaking of bad screens and ghosting, I never had a problem with the screen, by the way, but I want to save a special section of this talking about the monochrome stuff. Anyway, I also had Super Off-Road, which, if you've seen one of the three videos I've done on three different versions of that, you know I like that game. Speaking of the Game Boy version of that, and specifically, before I go on, I've mentioned it slightly in the videos I did on the console versions of Super Off-Road, and also when I showed the one in my compilation disc on the GameCube for Midway Arcade Treasures 3, which is the actual arcade game. The main problem I had with the Game Boy version, I'm pretty sure I can't be the only one, because there was no color monochrome. By the way, there's a way they could have differentiated your truck, but they just didn't decide to. All the trucks are the same. They're all white. There's no way to tell which one is yours. Even if you played the game a lot like me, you know yours on the very first track is the one in the bottom right corner. The problem is, every now and then, you are going to slip up and lose which truck is yours, especially when they get in a pileup. One of the things that's funny about every version of that game is when the trucks get in, like, this mangled mess of color. That is, if it has color in one of the versions you're playing. It's like they're in some kind of, like, I don't even know what to call it. You can't tell, and then you lose track of which one you are, and that's where the problem happens. But I did have other racing games for it. Of course, knowing me, you watch me for any length of time, you know one of two things, at least as far as video games go. Doom Racing. Alright, other racing games I had for it. One, I'm not exactly sure this is the full name of it, but I think it was, because that's all I remember seeing, is called F1 Race. Wow, that is so mind-meldingly poetic. F1 Race. Oxymoron much. It's the one with the label on the car, just shows the F1 car in the corner, and it's just got like a rocket booster coming out. It's one of the earlier games for the GameCube. No, slow down. It also had a multiplayer function where you play up to four players. I remember that being one of the few at that time, for a long time, you could actually play with four players. That was interesting. I only ever did it with two. My stepbrother. Only time I ever got to use that cable, too, by the way. So there's your answer for the Pokemon one. No, never got to do that. But that's Pokemon. Oh, we got a ways to go yet. I got a lot more to talk about, you know. Going back to racing, there's this one game which I did a video on quite a while ago. I'm pretty sure it's up, but I think it got corrupted, so I didn't realize it, and I had to take it down and remake it, and I didn't remake it yet. It's one of those two, whatever. And Sultataku made a comment on the video. I remember this specifically, and he said, "I thought I was the only one that knew about this game or liked it." Yeah, I thought the same thing, too. To this day, I've never heard more than like three people bring its name up. It's not like it's notoriously bad. It's not like it's some obscure rare game. It's valuable. It's not none of the above. It's just very forgettable. It's not horrendously bad, but there's things about it that are bad. And I don't want to make this about review, a little mini review of each game, but Jeep Jamboree is another one I had. There was another racing game I had for it, but I didn't like it at all, and I got rid of it really quick. I can't remember its name, but I will tell you this. I looked it up when I did remember it one time, and it turns out it's pretty much the lowest rated racing game on the Game Boy. Now, I know what I've said about rating scores, which is true, but I didn't really look at the numbers. I was looking at what people were saying, you know, that. I was reading what was being said, and then I combined that from other ones I've read and what my own memory was, and the average aggregate, I guess you would call it, consensus is, yeah, it sucks. It happens. Anyway, I had, moving on from there, I had some other Nintendo games, can't remember what it is. I did not have Metroid 2, unfortunately. I wish I did. I still haven't played it, by the way. As much as I love Metroid. Didn't have that Zelda game on it. Probably would have loved it, to be honest. I had, what is it? I think it's just called Golden Sun. It doesn't have a subtitle. I had that. Only kind of RPG I had on it. I mean, it is an RPG, but not like when I think RPG, especially back then, even now when I think back then. Final Fantasy, if it's Nintendo, and Phantasy Star, if it's friggin' Sega. Unless you move up to the Saturn, and I have a whole lot of other ones I throw in there, but whatever. They, V-A-Y on the Sega CD. But anyway, I'm gonna do a video on that. But anywho, so yeah, I had a decent variety for the Game Boy, more than I did for any of the later handhelds from Nintendo. I just want to point that out. In fact, DS, I had all RPGs but one game. I didn't even plan on that. It's just what happened. But that's way off. That's when I get to the DS. Oh, God. Can't wait to talk about that one. Especially when I complained about the original one. Oh, God. Blocky. Ugh. Made my hand hurt. Anyway. Alright, let's talk about that, actually, since I just made a joke. Let's talk about... I want to actually talk about the Game Boy itself when you're holding it and using it. I like the Game Gear more, I guess, if I had to think about it now. I actually have a Game Gear on the floor that one I still haven't fixed. I'll get around to it. I actually haven't forgotten about it. Or the GameCom. I preferred... I don't know how to say it. Like, the parts where you hold the Game Gear on the sides. Imagine if there were handles where the D-pad is and the A and B button are actually 1 and 2. My bad. Let me fix that. 1 and 2 on the Game Gear. There's a slight raise to it and bumps, kind of bulgy. It feels good on this, like... I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but like the muscle where your thumb goes down below, which is one of the reasons why we have opposable thumbs, it's called a saddle joint. Around that area, it feels really good on the Game Gear, and I'm getting really anatomical. It feels really good there. The problem I always had with the Game Boy, I thought it was not wide enough. It is pretty thick, but I meant like wide, as in when you're looking at the screen. It's just one of my things. I always wish it was like 2 inches wider. Believe it or not, that little bit would actually make a great difference into what I'm thinking. But that's just me. Overall, though, I'd still use it. I wouldn't give a crap, really. Buttons, really nice. Felt great. In fact, at one point, for a very, very short time, I thought they were better than the friggin' buttons on the Super Nintendo. It's stupid, I know, but they really did feel good. Maybe it's because they're a little bit bigger. I just noticed it more or something. They're basically the same. I made them the same way as on the Super Nintendo. In fact, they're the same color. Slightly darker. The convex ones, not the concave ones, you know, A and B on the Super Nintendo controller. Start and select buttons were just rubber. Basically, I always thought they just made smaller versions, yanked right off the Super Nintendo controller. Why not? D-pad was great. That is the definite area where I thought the Game Boy was superior to the Game Gear. I like the Game Gear D-pad, don't get me wrong, but if I had to compare the two, I'd go with the Game Boy one just because I like that traditional, like, T cross shape. Because it doesn't have, like, it's not a fat, chubby arrow. I don't know, maybe it's just me. That's what I always liked. That's what I liked about the Super Nintendo controller. That's what I liked about the Genesis Mega Drive controller, the Saturn controller. Pretty much every D-pad that's like that. So there's, you know, that. It was pretty hefty in its weight. I liked that. It gave a nice weighty feel to it. Felt like you're actually holding something and didn't, like, accidentally drop the damn thing, forgetting you had a hold on it. Yeah. The contrast, I probably should leave this for the screen, which I'll do next before I keep forgetting it. Alright, let's go into the volume. I used the headphone jack probably twice in the entire time I ever owned the damn thing. Not because I didn't have headphones. Oh, I actually had really high-end headphones for back then. I've always been a real, whatever you want to call it, for audio, and anytime I had a chance to get really high-end headphones, as high-end as I could get, I would. So yeah, I didn't have the crappy ones, and it did sound good. I did use crappy ones on it too, because I actually was, even back then at my age, I was curious. And sound was really good on the Game Boy, considering what it is. It wasn't that bad. I can think of quite a few songs I really liked from the games I had. Super Mario Land in particular, I really loved the theme for. I can think of quite a few Game Boy games that, you know, like ones I've rented. I also rented a lot of Game Boy games. It's pretty much the only handheld, by the way, I rented games for. I did rent one PSP game, but whatever. And I know which one it was, and it wasn't that great. And moving on. As far as things I wish I got to play on the Game Boy, I can't really give anything specific other than that Metroid game, which I didn't even know of its existence. Apparently a lot of people forget it exists. I heard it's called the Black Sheep of the Metroid series. I never liked that term because I don't understand what the crap it means. Then you got things like Metroid Pinball and the Game Boy Advance. It's like, that's not the oddball in that family. Okay. Metroid Pinball, we'll accept that, but the one actually plays like the original Metroid on the NES on the Game Boy? Yeah, we're not going to count that. It's because it's got no color. It was like watching TV in the 50s. Ah, we ain't going to count that. Anyway, let's talk about the screen now since I keep wanting to do that. First off, that little plastic thing that goes on the actual front of the thing that covers the actual screen itself. Great idea. I'm just going to put that out there. I did not abuse my Game Boy, as I said, but oh, I've seen some messed up ones, and yeah, that they would have to buy a new one if it wasn't for that. I've seen some of them, that plastic part really messed up, but you could still see the game okay enough most of the time to play it. So there's that. And now the screen itself. It's all about that contrast option on that knob. I actually came up with a very specific way how to adjust mine. Now, I've always fought this with any screen like this. It's dependent on each person, much like the 3D on the 3DS. Every person has a different comfort level with that, or vision level, because not everyone can actually see that 3D effect. Some people are immune to it. They just can't see it for various reasons. I'm not, by the way. The same thing applies with this contrast thing, although it's a little bit different. It has to be dark enough to actually see objects, but light enough that it's not, like, complete black square, which if you cranked it all that way, you could, and crank it all the other way. Hey, I'm playing an invisible game, you can screw with people, or you can make them think the screen's broken. Or like that person that was an actor in that video, like Nintendo training. Yeah, stuff like that. I didn't have a problem with the screen. I didn't mind it was monochrome, which actually is technically not. It's actually yellow and greenish yellow, piss colored and sour cream and onion. I don't know how to explain it. But the funny thing is, if you play any Game Boy games on the emulator without using any of the color filters, which that was real fun, I gotta talk about that next, it actually is monochrome. It's just the filter color thing they put on there makes it look yellow and green. The screen itself does too. But in reality, if you were to have a direct feed of the game, which they could do, they had a way. If you ever see that video, it's on YouTube, you really should check it out too, because it's really cool, especially if you're in a Nintendo. Like, old kiosks, this guy, it was made back then, so they were new, and he was showing, like, how you service them and all that, how you open them, and one of them is the Game Boy one. It's got a direct feed to the Game Boy game on the screen. It's interesting, but anyway. I always wish I knew how they did that. I don't want to do it, I just want to know how it's done. Anyway, apparently people can get this now, it's very expensive, but you can buy it for your 3DS. That's how N. Tom does it on Hellfire Commentaries. Anyway, the colors. For those of you who don't know or never had a Game Boy or one or the other and don't remember, if you held a certain, like if you held B or A and used the D-pad or you just moved the D-pad, when the Game Boy technically BIOS screen comes up, when it goes DINK and it shows the Game Boy logo, it says Game Boy, you can make it do different color schemes. Or is that the Game Boy Color? No, that was Game Boy Color. My bad. Take back what I said. Just forget about what I said. I didn't mean that. I'm wrong. It's Game Boy Color. Jumping ahead. Anyway, let's move on from there. Talking about in general about the games for the Game Boy, I liked a lot of them I played. I was disappointed in some areas. No, it wasn't have to do with the games weren't in color. Get that out of the way. I did not have a problem with it not being in color. Believe me. I watch a lot of old, really old stuff that's in actual black and white. Doesn't bother me. I've also seen silent movies. It doesn't bother me. Certain things, like certain games that are on the Game Gear, but I knew they were never going to be on the Game Boy at all. Like, there's this one racing game I absolutely love on the Game Gear. Wish it was on the Game Boy, because I owned my own Game Boy. It wasn't. But, oh well. And then there's some games that are on the Game Boy, but they're also on, like, the Game Gear or something else. The Game Boy got the short end of the stick, the worst version, for whatever reason, hardware or otherwise. You know, stuff like that. But in the end, I really like what's on it. I wish there was like a Final Fantasy game on it that I think there, even to this day, I'm not sure if there is an actual Final Fantasy game on the Game Boy. I think there is. I mean something on the level kind of like the NES ones, or hell, maybe even a port of the NES one. Obviously, it wouldn't be in color. Or Super Nintendo, something like those that plays like those. I don't think there is, not that I can remember. Or I've looked up in recent times. I probably should again, but I keep forgetting. I really don't pay attention to handhelds much anymore, even old ones. I just don't have any interest in it. But anyway, I really liked it. One of the reasons the Game Boy won, of course, any system over another, its competitor, is the library. Let's be honest. Yeah, used four double A's. Actually got really good battery life. Yeah, that's not that big of a deal. Even now, it's not that big of a deal. You got rechargeable ones now. That's all I use. So there's that. There's a couple other things. Who cares? All right, now we got to talk about Pokemon. I realize this is how many minutes in? 20 minutes and 42 seconds in, according to the counter. I guess maybe this is how I'll end it. And oh, actually, no, there's one more thing I can think of. I'm not going to go on about this forever because I really can't. I've said this many times before. Anytime someone asks me about Pokemon, it comes up, or I just decide to say it about it, and I'm watching something that's related to Pokemon. To this day, I really only can stand the first generation. I owned Red, Yellow, and Blue. Obviously, Yellow came out after those two, so not that order. I got Red first, then Blue, then Yellow. In fact, Red was one of the first games that was bought for me for the Game Boy that wasn't the one that came with, Tetris. I played Pokemon. This is going on about Pokemon itself, not so much the Game Boy, but I might as well bring this up because it's necessary at this point. I only ever started playing any of those and wanted to because they were an RPG. Again, at the time, and even now, I wasn't aware of many RPGs on the thing other than the one I had, which was Golden Sun, which I got after that. I didn't know of any, and I really loved RPGs, so what was I supposed to play, Yeah, I could play Final Fantasy 4 and 3 I had on the friggin' Super Nintendo, but what if I wasn't around then? What if I went to out to eat and I was bored to death and wanted to slam my head on the table from boredom, like I usually get from back then, or I could play on my Game Boy with the little snake light I had, by the way. It was really cool. I had a snake light. I also had a magnifying thing you put on the thing, you attach it to the little EXT port. It was all cool. I didn't feel like talking about the accessories. I could if I want, but it's nothing interesting. It doesn't work unless you can see what they look like. I had two snake lights. Anyway, going back to game Pokemon, which is what I was actually talking about. I only ever bothered with them because they were RPGs. That's it. I didn't give a flying crap about anything else. I skipped through everything they're talking about the first time around, and I've obviously played it more than that. In fact, you're gonna be surprised what I have to say about that. I bet I'm the only person that's ever done this. Maybe. You never know. I did like the monster gimmick with it. I thought it was interesting because I was thinking, it's like, well, instead of Final Fantasy where you're stuck with particular characters, even though I like the characters a lot, one of the reasons I love Final Fantasy. Again, I can't talk about Final Fantasy much anymore. It's just, don't ask me to. Just don't. Same with Resident Evil. I tell you now. And Need for Speed. Those three series, I can't do it. It's too much. I liked using the different monsters and all that. I liked how the certain monsters evolved into other ones. Of course, me not understanding what it was really about, I was expecting one to be looking like Godzilla, but whatever. I was hoping for it. Charizard ended up being my favorite. Whatever. Still is, kinda. It's a dragon, looks like a dinosaur. It's close to Godzilla. Orange, though, with wings. Whatever. Shoots out fire out of his mouth, kinda like Godzilla's atomic breath. I can pretend. I did rename him Godzilla. Actually, I think I named him Zilla. Just because he was like, he's not close enough, I can't give him the full-on name. Whatever. I'll call him Anguirus. Or Megalon, something stupid. Anyway, something he doesn't even look remotely like. King Ghidorah, if only that would fit. Oh. Anyway. Mothra, just to make fun of him. Now I'm talking about Godzilla. Listing off every monster. Whatever. Yeah, I did like the whole thing about it. I thought it was cool going to the different regions, capturing the different monsters. I like how all the different moves. That was the thing that really caught my attention with Pokemon, was all the different moves at the time. I thought it was weird at first. It didn't bother me. I didn't have a problem with it. I dealt with it fine. It's just, I didn't understand, why can I only use this move a certain amount of times, where this move I can use a lot more than this one, and this one's only like 5. Yes, I understood some were more powerful than others, but then there's ones that are really powerful, just like this one, and they're pretty much just as powerful, but this one can only be used 5 times, this one can only be used 10 times. Why is this one more than the other one when they both basically do the same amount of damage? I don't know. That's the kind of stuff I was thinking at the time. And then I eventually got the other one so I could get all the other Pokemans. Yellow annoyed the living shit out of me because of one thing. And I'm pretty sure you can guess what it is. You can't stick frickin' Pikachu in the damn ball. Oh, God. Now, I've mentioned this before, real short. I'll bring this up again. I was one of the people back then where they actually sent this tape out. Dave the Usher, who I bring up every now and then, who's the person I watch the most for, like, playthroughs, let's plays, whatever crap you want to call him. He calls them Game Replay. He's got his own unique name for it. He was one of them too, and when I was watching, I was like, oh shit, I can't believe someone else is, I found someone else was one of those guinea pigs. I had the taste back then, I was watching the show, I was like, where have I seen this before? Oh, damn it, man, it's this thing they were doing in the show where he doesn't want to be in the ball. But then, you know, I was thinking, and this is why I'm saying it, I thought, you know, since this is a game, you could do a lot more in this than you can in like a 22-minute cartoon show. What if there's a way to get him in the ball? I probably tried once for about an hour and a half to get the friggin' asshole in the ball until I figured out, nope, there ain't no way to do it. In fact, throughout the entire first time I was playing for Yellow, I talked to everyone literally at least twice. Sometimes I wasn't paying attention, I actually reloaded to talk to that person again, just in case I missed something. It was like, they tell me how to do this, it's like, this is annoying the living hell out of me. Why can't I get him in the ball? Why is everyone else in the ball but he can't be? It's like, boy, what was this, like my 7th one? Because he's like, I got an extra one in Yellow and I can't carry 6 on my belt or some crap like that. It's like a Pokemon version of a 6-shooter. What is this? But no. It's just a little funny story I can tell you there. I'll probably tell it again when I talk about, if I ever make something talking about Pokemon. That's about a 30-minute affair. Kind of like this. But anyway, I never really cared about him much after the Game Boy, the original 3. I did have Ruby for the Game Boy Advance, that's jumping ahead again, but I felt more like it was a kind of upgraded, rehashed, with not interesting monsters as the original Red. One last thing, the thing I actually wanted to mention about Red, this is the most interesting thing, probably, of this whole entire thing I'm going to say in this whole video. I literally actually played Red enough, used it enough, that I wore the battery out. It didn't die from age, it didn't die from not being used, it literally died from me using it and playing through the game. I must have played through that game from beginning to end, I don't know how many times. That and Tetris. I don't know. Yeah, I cheated and used Rare Candy and all that crap and Game Shark, but whatever. I played that a lot. But anyway, in the end, the thing I want to say about the Game Boy is, it was kind of like a handheld version of the NES. Again, no color, I know. Mono, just like the NES. But the games that were on it were a little bit different than the NES in the way that it's well known that the NES, majority of the games on the thing are bad. There's no doubt about it. The majority of games on the NES are bad. It's just, there's many factors, and I've explained it before, so have other people, so I'm not going to do that here. But with the Game Boy, I found that there was things you can play that were more fun on the go than I could on the console, which I didn't know at the time until I got the Game Boy. And taking the Pokemon factor out, because I didn't mention this, but it's kind of obvious, everyone knows this by now, but if you don't, Pokemon is basically the thing that put the Game Boy on the map. I mean, it's still falling to this day. I know they don't use the Game Boy name anymore, but have you seen the insane amount of talking people do about Pokemon X and Y? Yeah. It isn't dead yet. So, there's that. Taking that out, though, the Game Boy on its own still had a lot of great stuff for it. Stuff I didn't even mention that I still know about, but, you know, this is going forever if I just list off every damn game for it that is good. I mean, Ninja Bear Hug. There you go. Just go watch his stuff. He plays a lot of Game Boy games and shows them. More ones I didn't even talk about. And the Game Boy really does deserve its place in game history. It really is. I don't say it's hard to say if it is the best handheld. Nah, I like the Game Boy Advance more, as I've mentioned before, for various reasons. But I rank the Game Boy up there really high, really. It really is amazing in how much it achieved. It was their first handheld, not counting the Game and Watch, I'm aware of that, that really took off. One of the first handhelds that really did massively, and it's not hard to see why. It really is good. I mean, I've heard people who've never used one in their entire life, and all these years later, get a hold of one and play the or just play the games on it, and they really are impressed with it, you know? And yeah, I really enjoyed the one I had. I had it for many, many years, up until about 2008, and I actually did. That is when I got rid of it in 2008. Had it all the way then. It was actually bought for me and held for me for quite a while. It was bought new, but it was given to me about 2 years or a year after it was bought for some reason I can't remember. It's very vague. And that's basically also when I started going to that game store I mentioned all the time that I've been going there all my life. That was the first thing that was bought there for me. So there you go. It's also significant in that way because I still go there to this day, and I will be really sad if it ever goes away, that place, because I don't know where I can go that I can trust that much, the people who work there, and I'm not going to get ripped off, and I'll get a good deal and actually find what I want. But I'll deal with that when it comes to it. Anyway, I realize it's been a very long time since I've done the last system talk, but I forgot. Sorry. But you know, I've gotten around to this now. The next one, I don't know if it'll be the Game Boy Color. I gotta go in order. I can't just jump to the advance. Might be a console next one. Slightly shorter than what this is. But, you know, still. Do something else. Play a game. Listen to this. You know, have fun listening to me talk about my memories of the Game Boy and how flawed they are with the case of the color thing. That's the Game Boy Color and Advance. You can do it on the Game Boy Advance, okay? I'll correct myself one more time. You cannot do the color thing on the Game Boy. Only on the Game Boy Color and the Game Boy Advance. It's in the word color. Game Boy doesn't have color. Not any kind of actual color you would call it. So, that's all. Thank you for listening if you did and you enjoy this. Like I said, just this kind of thing is something you're supposed to listen to in the background, obviously. I'll have some kind of picture that shows the Game Boy or some funny picture of the Game Boy. And feel free to talk about what you remember of the brick, or even do a response. I don't know. It's up to you. So that's it, and I will see you next time. Adios.